I got to talk. I got to tell what I feel. I got to talk about my life as I see it.
Biggie.
What's up, you clowns? Charlie Green back here again with my esteemed colleague, as always, Michael Gary Barham, a.k.a. Special Decisions, a.k.a. Quarter of a Bag of Orange Chicken, a.k.a. Sam and Lois' dad, a.k.a. Nikki's worst half.
Thanks for having me back. You should acknowledge your references to. I just told you what I had for dinner, which was Trader Joe's frozen orange chicken, and you commented on the amount of calories as if it was something I didn't know.
Did you have anything else with the orange chicken?
Of course, yeah. I had a full meal. We put it with some rice left over, orange chicken. Mm. Steamed dumplings, all of it, very borderline, not really that enjoyable of a meal, but you know, sometimes you just gotta get it done. It was stuff that had been in the freezer for. I was checking the date, like the free, you know, some of the
freezer
frozen
dates
doesn't even have dates. Some of it,
it's frozen. Who cares?
I don't know. One of the items that I took out from the freezer, which was like a pork shumai, had a date of May 2021.
You still ate it.
So I thought that's a year and a half ago. So I thought even frozen, we should forego the pork shumai.
Well, I don't want to be prejudiced, but how did you reheat the rice?
Precious. I added water. It's saved in a glass container.
Oh,
so I added some water and I reheated it with some in the microwave with some additional water.
That's great, man. That's great. No butter?
You were gonna assume like white people like reheat their rice without additional water and it's really dry. Is that what?
Yeah,
that's what you meant by being prejudiced,
right?
White people just like really dry rice. Is that how?
Well, you really like if you have enough time, you shouldn't reheat rice in the microwave.
I don't know. I think water in the microwave rice, it's fine as long as it's moist to begin with. Nicole actually makes really good rice the first time. So it didn't look like dry rice.
Right.
It was moist to begin with.
That's good. Appreciate the moist rice. Shout out Nikki for that.
She's really good. She's really good at that.
That's great.
Oh, yeah. Great. And I didn't eat 1,500 calories of orange chicken. I'm not a psycho.
I'm not so bad. Eating 1,500 calories of orange chicken makes you a psycho. That's good.
I mean, you feel really weird. It's not like 1,500 calories even of like a steak. It's really like I get restless leg. Like it's sugary. You would feel very weird after that.
You know, the original Panda Express is out here in Glendale, California. It's right next to me here. It's called the Panda Inn.
Oh, it's called the Panda Inn.
Yeah.
Is it like a tourist attraction?
Well, maybe I'll take you if you ever come visit me with your lazy ass. You should get on an airplane, bro. Come visit me.
I have visited you.
That was years ago. I lived in a different city.
Is it considered a different city? Your son was turning one.
Yeah, it's a different city. It's all right. We won't hold this against you. Okay. On today's show, we will be broaching a few subjects. I'm going to switch it up here a little bit for you guys and gals out there. Shout out Lisa. Shout out Josh. for
Lisa. Wait, Lisa Gilman Rosen, first confirmed female listener.
Right, first confirmed listener outside of the inner circle. That is, this is all that matters.
No, that's not true. Wes Green was the first.
Oh, right.
You're obviously not tracking this closely. Wes Green, I thought you were the data guy.
I'll get Wes a spreadsheet going. Yeah, my bad.
You got to track it. Wes Green was first, then Lisa. I did predict that I had hopes it would be Emily, would be the first female listener. That was my initial prediction. She blew it. It was too loud for her in the car.
See, I would have made that a long shot. I would have made that a long shot. That would have been.
You have to think about the context. It was a car. Mike's in the car more than other people. That was it. Mike was more likely to be driving and put it on.
He's in the car more than other people with his wife? I would say probably not. I bet he's in the car with his wife about the same amount of time that you are. But I could be wrong. I mean, I am the data guy, so I can get it right.
Anyway, the point is that the handouts had the chance, and they blew it because Emily thought it was too loud. Wow. Mike acquiesced.
Maybe that's what he should change his team name to.
Mike acquiesced.
Acquiesced. I don't even know. I couldn't even begin to know how to spell that word. So.
A-C-Q-U-I-E.
Acquiesce. Okay, nice.
Thank you.
All right, man. So I thought I'd bring up this subject only because, you know, we're almost all the way to the middle of the season here, and you know, people are taking some losses, people are getting some wins. You know, I always really hate losing to you, and I really hate losing to Handel for some reason. So I'm not really sure why, but those are my two rivalry games.
Really interesting. Me and Handel are the two that you hate losing to most. That's interesting. I wonder, because I guess I'm a little surprised about that.
The Handel thing comes from
the most.
Okay. Oh, surprise, surprise. The Handel thing, I think, comes from, like, you know, growing up together and both being so competitive. I hate losing to Mike. Everything. I used to hate getting worse presents than Mike at Christmas time. We would like call each other and tell each other's presents, and I'd be like, man, his presents were better than mine.
Well, I wish I was a fly on the wall in that conversation.
You were so
silly. Hey, man. Like,
9-year-old talking about.
I wasn't included. I knew you guys. I wasn't included on those calls. Maybe since I
only got home. Was 3-way calling possible?
Yeah. That was actually probably the height of 3-way calling. You like called someone on the landline. You know, you had to talk to a parent probably. It's just so awkward. That's something everybody just bypasses now. You never have to talk to a parent unless you're in person. These kids just on the iPads with each other, TikToking,
FaceTiming.
That's it.
That's what the kids do. The kids FaceTime. I just traditional call, but like I feel the young people, like they rather FaceTime than call. It's crazy.
FaceTime's awful. Really.
It's horrible. It's brutal. It's terrible.
It's brutal. And then my mom, like my family likes to FaceTime, like when she's visiting people. I think she thinks it's like a way for me to keep in touch with some of my cousins.
Oh yeah.
And like she'll be like, oh, we'll all be together at dinner tomorrow. We'll FaceTime you. Mm. And that it's like, so you're FaceTiming with 10 people.
I'm the worst kind of FaceTimer. Yeah, I'm the worst because I'll start a FaceTime or accept a FaceTime and literally just hand it to Lara. Just like walk away.
Well, right. Yeah, that is exactly right. That is actually also what someone like my mom does.
Right.
She's like, we'll be at home. Like, talk to Michael. But like that, it's an interesting personality trait. My mom does the same kind of thing like with my kids. Like she can't sit still, so she'll like finish dinner early and she gets up faster than my kids. She's like, okay, let's go for a walk, you know, they live near horses, go see the horses. But then she doesn't actually want to go and she asks someone else to do it.
Right. And she'll get mad if she's like me, she'll get mad if you don't do it.
Right. What is it about you and my mom? Like, you're weirdos. And you also answered your FaceTime at the draft, which
we went over that. We reviewed that.
Did we?
Already reviewed. Yeah. I think we were talking about draft behavior, and that was definitely something you brought up before. So.
Oh my God, that was awful etiquette. That was just confusing too. It's like you don't have to answer your phone, even if it's your wife.
Yeah.
You're good. Do you do that, or no matter what, especially when your wife calls, you answer. You answer me most of the time.
I'm a phone answer. You know, what I like the most about doing that is it just makes me more reliable as a human being. Like, you know, and I think like you'll call me more because you know I'll pick up. Even if I have to say, no, I can't talk right now, I still pick up the phone.
That's true. That's a very good point. I call you more because most people don't pick up. Like you can't even, my phone's never, my ringer is basically never up.
I don't think Handel has a phone anymore. I call him and he doesn't answer, and then it tells me the mailbox is full. So like, I'm not sure.
Oh my God. What an embarrassment if your mailbox is full. Or that's like your voicemail hasn't been set up yet.
That's the funnier one.
Does that happen anymore? Yeah, I just actually got that today, and I judge the person. I judge the recipient. Yeah. I get it. Like, you don't want voicemails, but you got to figure out a way to show that you're not a sloppy mess.
Well, voicemailing is really obsolete at this point, you know?
Well, I agree.
There's just no need at all.
I actually, if I call someone, like a work person that I don't know that well, if I call them but they don't pick up, I do not leave a voicemail. Which I think is a little weird, but I still would prefer to email them.
Yeah.
Because that's less rude than like, it's like actually rude to leave someone a voicemail almost.
Right. Because now I have to like do, I don't even know how to log in. I forgot my PIN. I have to go, you know.
I don't think it's that hard. Mine, like, show up. I can read mine. But still, I don't do it.
That's my favorite. That's my favorite. You're having a conversation with somebody. They say something. You agree. And then they disagree with you to the extent to which you agree to that with them. That's good. I like that.
So it just happened? I am a fan of voice notes, though. It's actually a very good way to communicate with people.
The voice note, you mean like, you mean
the voice
like
text
box?
Like, yeah, you hold the thing. Half the people listening to this do not even know how to do this, I bet. You hold the thing like in your text message, where you, right next, on the right of where you would type. You hold it, and then you just start talking. And then you just hit the arrow.
Yeah. Hey, Sean, let us know if you know what that is. Sean.
No, multiple. Don't put Sean on his own. Like, probably, I don't, Josh doesn't know. I doubt.
Mm.
Fish might know. Fish is relatively tech-savvy.
Fish knows. Yeah, Fish knows. Fish knows. So, like, okay, so, you know, so those are the people I hate to lose to the most. How do you feel about the, like, follow-up text after a loss from the winner about... How do you feel about those?
Well, I think it depends. I normally try to, like, say something modest, you know, good game. And I do also try when I lose, because I dislike the person less. So I lost to Ben and Josh, and I said, good game. And, like, so I start the conversation, because I'd rather communicate with the person rather than hate them, like let it fester.
I see.
I hate them less if we can have a nice exchange. But this is why, because we all take it too seriously, this is why nobody talks shit in our league, because we all can't handle it.
I think we should try.
I like to have a nice, friendly conversation if I'm losing. If I'm winning, I might also say good game. That's it. I'm going to keep it friendly.
No, you do the thing. You do the thing where it's not over yet. It's not over yet, but like
you. Oh no! But that's because of you. That's because you. And this was a Gangel specialty Gangel move when I was shared a team with him. The mush, he would do it actively, and everyone would get so annoyed at him. He'd be like, bro, oh, I can't believe this, dude. You're killing us. Nice win. And kids would be like, dude, shut your mouth. And you do that too. It's not over. Like, it has to be very clear that's over. I sent to Ben, like, it was clear that I could not win. Anything, right. If you do, and this is a very, it's a fine line, but you do the good game when you're down 25 and you have, like, a decent player left. That's not over. You don't know what could happen. I said to Ben I was down like 60 with two players who can't really score 30 each. That's over. But that is a distinction.
Willits did that to me. He with Derek Carr threw that touchdown. And that should do it for you.
Oh, that's why he did that.
And then he proceeded to beat me by 20 points.
Because Travis Kelce in the first quarter.
In the first that. Quarter.
Bad out of here. Terrible etiquette by Willits. Wow. I'm surprised. I did not know that he did that.
He was crowning me the whole Sunday. And then the morning we talked on Monday morning, and he told me, it's like, oh man, Khalil Shakir got you the win. See, got you the win. Did it the whole
wow. Also, that is a Gangel move.
I mean, it worked. I think it's actually strategically pretty savvy, actually. I think it came back. It worked out for him. So
I've seen it work for Handel. Or excuse me, Gangel. Handel does Here's the question, though. Did Willits text you when he took – like, were you guys texting throughout the game?
Nope, that was the original text from the game.
That was the first text of the game, and then there was no more texting?
Well, I was trying to refrain because I knew what was happening. I literally – so when I said to him – when we spoke on the phone, I said, worst-case scenario is the Raiders go up 14-0 and Jacobs has one of the touchdowns.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he told me
that's literally what happened. And, right. But it's one of these things, man. It was 1 out of 3. At least that's what the probability said on the thing. It's not that crazy of a loss.
Not sure that I trust those probabilities. Like, sometimes, like, there's nobody left.
Right.
And it still gives me a percentage chance.
Yeah.
I mean, like, what do the percentages mean? Like the world.
So players I don't mind losing to the most. I think, Sam Green, I like losing to Sam. Not a big deal.
Oh, you like it?
I like Sam. He's a very – he's a good guy. I like him. Yeah, he handles himself well from an etiquette standpoint. Don't normally mind losing to Willits, except this time was a little – got under my skin.
He crossed the line. He crossed an etiquette line that'll linger. That'll hurt you. That'll hurt him.
Hey, listen. We'll see. See how it goes. How about you? Who don't you mind losing to? Losing your
good graces. I do not mind losing to most people in this league. And I actually think I used to mind losing to Ben more. But I find the more you communicate with the person, the less you mind. That's how I approach. So if I'm losing, I actually communicate more. If I'm winning, I don't really say much.
Right. You let it come to you.
That's the real best etiquette. You let the other person, the losing person, drive the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
The winner should just
let
it flow because you're winning.
Yeah. This guy scored 4 touchdowns with 24 yards, bro. Shit was crazy. Never seen anything like it. Okay.
I wasn't watching the second half. Were you
I went out to watch it. I was at a bar with some friends out here watching. And they were all like everybody we were all just laughing at me. It was funny.
That's that makes it better. Oh.
You're like, my friend texted me the next morning. He's like, "Yo, I think Travis Kelce just scored another touchdown, bro."
I was like, that made it fun though. You did the annoying thing where you told everyone the exact parameters of your matchup. You like showed up. Everyone's like excited to watch a football game, and then they have to watch the football game like in the context of Charlie.
Right. Well, what else would I do? I mean, it's fine etiquette if. If the watching is predicated on fantasy football, like it's like a fantasy football conversation on text that turned into let's go watch the game.
It sounds like it made it fun, but I've been to Super Bowl parties where it's like we all focus on like one person's betting situation,
and you don't like
and like that person makes their betting, like everybody talks about it, and it. It's like a little interesting, and then you ask questions, whatever, and then it becomes like, oh, it's really like your party.
Right.
Well, this is why nobody cares about your fantasy team, but you somehow got everyone to care. And then they watched you lose, which made it fun. Like, that's the only way it was
fun. Yeah, it was fun. It was real fun, too. It was like literally, you know, like off the top rope type shit. Like, the last touchdown was just hilarious. It was hilarious, that last one.
But you were done at that point anyway. It was just funny.
Right. That's when, you know, you get past like another human. Quarter. Yeah, that's fine.
Josh Jacobs and Travis Kelce. Like, Josh Jacobs is so awesome. This guy should be like a top 10 fantasy player. I heard somewhere they like have him ranked 30. Like, Establish Rome was like, we ranked him 35th for the rest of the year. It's like, what?
What's wrong with you?
He'd be top five. This guy's like, yeah. He doesn't get all the touches on a pretty good team, and he's good.
Yeah. 30-something. Yeah, okay, bro. Like, people just still hate. Like, it's really just all about the name. Like, you took the name off of all these people. That's really how you should play fantasy football. It's just like, don't look at the name.
So you want to draft people just like
Statistics, that's it. Projections.
Previous year, statistics and projections.
Yep, that's it.
And then see if you can do it effectively. You can do that strategy. I've told you that what I'm going to do. And I think, you know what? I might come in next year.
Never draft a running back ever again.
I really don't want that. But close book.
Oh, close. Are you going to do the Jay-Z draft? You
do exactly. I can do it. I'm confident.
All right. I mean, this will be
scared this year, but I think I should have tried.
Well, this will be good. I will, you know, forever credit you with the most G thing ever done at a draft if you do that. So we'll be tracking. I'll be tracking that one. That one I'll be tracking.
You'll be tracking that. So what? Yeah. How would that compare to this year where I just drafted my fifth receiver before a running back? That was good.
I still think it ended up being the right thing to do, I think. I mean, the guy's a really good player.
Yeah, so. I should have continued to draft receivers. Next year will be different, though. Like, some of these guys really fell too far. Like, Josh Jacobs went super late.
Yeah. I mean, you know, I don't think you can predict. So, when they don't extend the guy, they draft a running back. And the system is never given somebody all the touches before. Like, how could you have predicted this? This is not something like, I think he went where he should have gone. It's just like, sometimes these players hit and sometimes they don't. Like, you can't play, like, can't be like, oh, well, this could be like Josh Jacobs. You still have to draft the guy where he should get drafted. It's just like some of them hit.
I guess. I think the thing, right. No, but that's true. He maybe could have gone a little earlier because he was still the person. Like, that's why people take presumed starters.
Right. Because it's more likely
that they get. Also, that's why, like, you can't just draft based on usage and, like, do this contract stuff. Like, and that's how you end up drafting Chase Edmonds. And, like, I just thought Chase Edmonds was good, but whatever. It's more like you still have – nobody talks about anyone's talent anymore. Like, Josh Jacobs is a good player.
Yeah.
Obviously, yeah,
like,
there
so
was
I a think scenario. I like the idea of closing your eyes and betting on the talent kind of thing.
I agree. You should always.
Well, that can transition us right into our trade analysis. And the first trade of mention, past the trade that we already discussed on this podcast, the first trade is the trade of the Moores, DJ Moore and Elijah Moore.
First trade. I did two trades this week.
I know, man.
First trade.
Pretty standard Mikey blah trades.
You know? Is that it? This one, I mean, this one was like, it, you know, this is just like, you don't need to drop a guy. Instead of dropping him, just ask your like show the player the respect. Ask your friend if he wants him.
And I'm more than happy to see if Elijah Moore takes a turn, because this is the close your eyes and bet on talent thing. Same with DJ Moore, very talented guy. You know,
maybe yeah, right. Turns it was a change of scenery trade. First,
yeah,
it happens occasionally. Typically, folks don't do it. Like position for same position, switch up the scenery.
I think they're ranked one apart this week. So
I was surprised you gave up DJ Moore given all the changes there.
I'm sick of it.
That's it. You're just over it. You don't want to look at him.
You know, and like to trade him for somebody who also like it wasn't for I was gonna cut him. So like in my mind, like, well, at least I'm giving this guy.
You also paid him the right respect.
Yeah. You know. So that's what just we're gonna do that now whenever we can. Pay respects.
Angel used to do the thing that you did separately, not the pay him the respect if you're gonna drop him, but just like he'd be like mad. He'd like really have emotional anger towards a player, and like he just like, I want him off my team.
And well, that's kind of like the way Fish dropped Allen Robinson. Like, you know, you do the just drop, you don't even pick anybody else up, you just drop him as soon as he's eligible to be dropped. You just drop him.
Nobody deserved that treatment more than do you see? Like, every time it's one of those things, like, every time I watch him. It's like hard for me to wrap my brain around how bad he is. And like, it does, it like, I'm starting to fish about it today. It's like a little bit, it like reminds me of a Nick signing. It like feels like it's like a dude who's so far past it. Like, he has no business being on the field. Like, they should agree, like, for his own sake. Like, if I don't think you can do this, NFL, if you just buy him out right now, tell him to leave. What? Like, give him some money, and he can save the effort and the embarrassment. Like, meet him halfway. Because this is depressing. It's sad.
Yeah.
It's hard. But I think he's just going to play out probably 2 years of a three-year deal, collect $30 million. Right. But it's not fun to watch. You see Sean McVay talking about it, and he was like, well, it's not his fault. I think that that's accurate. Like, it's not his fault. It's like, it's God's fault. Like, he is bad. Right.
It's just nature winning.
Sean McVay is trying to say it's the system. Like, it's not. It is a natural loss of talent.
Of ability. And everybody saw it happen, but nobody wanted to believe it. So...
Man, it's depressing. Well, it really is depressing. Well. But it's like nobody – it's God's fault. It's not his fault. God's fault. Nobody ever people thank God, but nobody ever blames God.
Speaking of God, how on God's green earth does Michael Willis continue to trade and always get the best player? Like, trade somebody nothing.
Speaking of – you're really getting good at this. Speaking of God.
How on God's green earth did he talk Handel into giving him these two players for nothing? How did he do that?
I found this trade because both the participants asked me about the trade separately, and it was I honestly had trouble analyzing. I'm like, literally, this is probably four people. Who, if they were all four, if they were free, I would not pick them up. Like, Fields is the only one I would have to think about, but I probably would not. I wouldn't pick up the other three guys. I understand Jameson Williams, like Mike said to him, I get that. So
how many Lions can you have? How many Lions can you have? What do you think? It's kind of like
I get Mike really wants a magnetic like rookie receiver because he has these issues. He drafted Justin Jefferson in the last round, last pick, Mr. Irrelevant, and he dropped him like 1 week too early. And then he like everybody else, he wanted Jamar Chase, and then he didn't get him, and he thinks like it's a him thing, and he blames you somehow for that. But he does blame you. Like you convince him.
I don't know how. That's only could a human who's completely misled believe that I had anything to do with that. So
I never said you did. I'm just saying that's you know that he blames you. It was a very odd thing to believe.
It's fine. I mean, whatever. You're just mumbling, just gobbledygook. It's not even a thing. So.
but anyway, the trade.
All right, so Jameson Williams, man, you really hope your season is – I hope you make it.
I mean, I don't know what you think – like how much fun you think it is to have a quarterback who throws like 12 passes a game. That's not fun.
I will say. So I try to split my time between fantasy analysis and actual football analysis. I try. And I think if there was ever a time where the arrow was pointing up on Justin Fields, I think it would be now. So, like, to get him now before he has a breakout game for a third-string running back and a person who may not even play football this season seems like a steal. But your
point is like he's gonna have a breakout game based on like what? Just he's playing the Redskins? Why is the arrow pointing out?
He's figuring it out a little bit. Like he still hasn't played a full season. He's not even had a full season yet. And you know, starting to like if you watch the Vikings game, I think he hit some throws in that game.
Yeah. No, like everybody else. All these people fall in love with the throws. The problem is, he takes too long to throw. His throwing motion, he's like bringing the ball all the way back, and he clearly is indecisive.
Well, this is I think, you know, where you also have to separate fantasy and real life because, like, if you look at the quarterbacks out there who may be available, you know, this is one of the only guys that people are down on that could score fantasy points. I mean, like, you're going to go out there and get. Who else is out there to get? So, I guess that's where we differ.
You don't want Matt Stafford. You don't want Matt Stafford. Whatever. He has almost 70 fantasy points, man.
Well, you know, I think you made your bed. You got to lay in that one, I think. I guess what's going to end up
happening. Yeah, I know. It's a little depressing. But I blame Allen Robinson, mainly. And then blame God. Really, I guess I have to just blame God. Johnson.
They could get OBJ.
Johnson blamed God. Do you remember?
They may sign Josh Gordon. Josh Gordon might sign over there.
I don't think Josh Gordon has anything left, man.
Yeah, no, it was a joke. It was a bad joke. It was a joke.
Well, it really was. Oh, Stevie Johnson, 2010.
Stevie Johnson. He was good. I think I had him at some point.
Blame God.
It was God's
fault? This is what he said. I praise you 24/7, and this how you do me. You expect me to learn from this? How? I'll never forget this ever. Thanks, though. That's a tweet.
Thanks, though.
After he dropped the game winner.
Said thanks, though. See, this is the problem with religion. Is like Robinson he doesn't believe that it was him that dropped the ball. Like, he dropped it, not God. God didn't drop it. He dropped
it. I'm just saying, people thank God. Nobody blames God. Allen Robinson, Sean McVay inadvertently blamed God when he said it's out of his control. Stevie Johnson directly blamed God. D move by Stevie. The only person I can think of who ever did it. I always think, though, that athletes, like, people get, you know, my dad gets annoyed. He's like, I was watching that he accepted the award. Why did he have to thank God so much? And why is he so religious?
Yeah.
But, like, you're not religious because you're, like, Lenny Barham. You're, like, a 5'8" Jew.
Right.
You know, nothing comes that naturally to you except, like, being OCD and, like, turning all the lights off. And I'm like,
the shower, should we tell the shower story?
You could dunk. You might like believe in God.
Right. Like, look what I can do. There must be a God.
Yeah.
You like, want to tell? Awesome. Do you want to tell the shower story? The Lenny shower story? I would like to hear it.
What is it? There's not a store. What story?
This is where he made you. He's yelling at you about showering for too long.
That's recurring. That was a recurring theme of my childhood. It's not one specific story. He would yell at me about showering too long because I'd be fucking up the paint. That's what my life was like. That's my story. But now I take long showers, and that's what Nicole has to live with. My showers last forever.
I think that's maybe that's where this not like you never want to be rushed thing. Like that's where the roots are. You know.
I think that's right. You get everything is a reaction to your parents. Yeah. I think, and I say this to Nicole a lot because every time we, hopefully my parents don't ever listen to this, but every time, we're here, just like she like has an aneurysm by the time it's over, and she can literally see them for like 30 minutes. Like it could be like a babysitting situation. She sees them at the front and the end, and she's like, Jesus Christ, about to have a nervous breakdown. And I do think that I should have been, given the way they are, I should have been crazy. Like, I think I'm relatively normal in that.
Yeah.
In context of how crazy these two people who raised me, it was just me and them.
Kudos to you. You know, I say the same thing. You should ask my wife, because I literally say the exact same thing to her. Like, how could I have ended up slightly normal? Having been through what I've been through in my life.
Yeah. Good for us, man. Yeah. And now we just talk to each other and 8 mm-hmm. to 11 other people listen.
It's great. It's great. Thank you, guys. We appreciate all of you out there. So could you walk me through what part of your childhood made you trade A.J. Dillon for Curtis Samuel?
Oh, I traded Curtis Samuel.
Right, the other way.
Your boy.
You're not watching that game, are you? Oh, my God. I can't believe
it. I already said this. Maybe I didn't say it to you, but the great thing about Thursday Night Football is you get to watch. I'll never watch these teams on a Sunday. And I will never – they don't even make it to the Red Zone channel. I feel like I never see the Bears. It's like weird Bears touchdowns like in the third quarter sometimes. I don't have any Bears. I traded away my only Redskin today. So I'm not going to watch these teams, but I'll watch them.
They're not the Redskins anymore, sir. Excuse you.
WFT. What are they called? The Commanders?
Look at you. Team. You're owning your own people and you're calling people Redskins, man. Jeez.
Sorry. Oh, well, I guess it's like I manage them.
Yeah. Just say something a little bit more woke, you know?
I don't think you can use woke in a positive sense anymore. Anyway, let me be clear. I have too many receivers. Curtis Samuel's good. But I needed a little running back chance to be good. A.J. Dillon's, you know, probably needs an injury to actually be good. But seems like a decent chance Aaron Jones is injured at some point.
Yeah, not a bad
guy. And he's a good player. Like, you can plug and play him in the right matchup. Like, he's an RB2, I guess. It's not that exciting, but sometimes he's going to get 15 to 20 carries. Anyway, there's another blah trade. Really, three just incredibly blah trades. This is like people with too much time on them. Just like trying to find little edges. Meaningless. All of it. Just really meaningless. But, you know, I like to transact. We kept it. We keep
transacting.
What do you think of the bids?
I was looking through
What do you think of the bids? Well,
I'm about to go check this out. So there's an interesting one here. Poo Poo Platter. You're gonna have to explain this one to me. There is a Robert Woods bid, winning bid of $1 by Poo Poo Platter, and he beat out Poo Poo Platter. $0, lower offer. So this was on October 5th.
That goes to show you
once again just revealed yourself not on Team Grind. I'll happily explain to you what Poo Platter did.
Please.
He put in multiple transactions based on who he was going to drop.
I understand doing that.
So he had one transaction with Robert Woods, a dollar, dropping whoever he dropped. And he had another different transaction with Robert Woods for zero, dropping a different person. That's it. That's the summary.
But then, I wasn't necessarily trying to expose myself. What I was trying to do is, like, how is this physically, like, how can you beat yourself out? How can they show it this way? How can you beat yourself out?
I didn't say you were trying to expose yourself, but you did. You revealed that you are not on TV.
Well, I'm never trying to expose myself. And I am on, this is going to bother me forever. You just know how to button the
push. You get back there.
All right.
Took some time off.
Oh, my God, bro.
Anyway, I just explained. He did two different transactions. He was dropping different people.
But why does it have to show it? Anyway, okay. So we have a pretty good, I like this one. This was good. The Raheem Mostert sweepstakes was pretty interesting. We had the winning offer of 28, Harris Smith with a $19 bid, Kingfish with 11. So much eggplant sucked. These QBs bid a dollar, Raheem Mostert.
But eggplant, that's why he's grinding, man. He's like, I'm just going to put everybody who I want
on a dollar. Yeah, because if I get him, who cares?
That's it. Is it? And you know what? It works. I think all those people are overpaying. I understand. Mostert's good. It's so hard for me to envision. Some people just don't have a chance,
right,
of lasting.
There's no chance.
There's no chance. Like, so if you play him, you maybe get a couple of games out of him.
Yeah.
You're playing a guy. 50 chance that dude's getting hurt that game.
Right. I mean, I don't know. I mean, the other big, big free agent acquisition of late within the last 2 weeks, same day, is Melvin Gordon III, $51 to Real King Fish, and Ben bid $44. So Fish did a great, excellent bidding by Fish here to acquire Melvin Gordon III. And Willett's, you know, just trying to show everybody up with a $4 offer here. I guess that is team grind because I, like, when I know that $4 will not win the player, I don't put it in here. So
that's exactly right. That's what that will. And yes. I bid on Mel. What did I bet?
25.
Okay.
$25. You really went for it.
I didn't think I'd get it.
You went for it in a way where you wouldn't get it. You knew you wouldn't get it.
No, I went for it. I chose a value. I valued Mel Gore. I put out my spreadsheets. And I used my secret calculations. And got them
to secret calculations. I will say my favorite of this past week, the 12th, was Fish's bid. I like the Alec Pierce acquisition. I think he's
like a white receiver.
I don't think he should be. I don't think he should have been out there, to be honest.
Well, I mean, he's a number two receiver on Matt Ryan's team. I'd say it's a good bit if you're Fish, who, like, you have concerns about your season, so you want to get a rookie. You know, put it out there. I thought, yeah, it's a good price. That's a nice little price. Mike bought Isaiah McKenzie so he could trade him a little value. Not sure that he's worth very much. Taysom, what do you think about the Taysom? People didn't bid. I mean,
I was going to call that out next. I mean, I love the flexibility of, I mean, whatever. Like, of all these tight ends, like, let's say you don't have a tight end you really like. I mean, might as well throw him out there. Why not? He's good at scoring.
I mean, how many tight ends can how many tight ends can score 35? Only one, your boy. Your boy who just did it to you, 30 points without even 30 yards.
Without even 30 yards.
It's like a Mike Allstott line this dude came out with.
Yeah.
That's got to be very rare.
I didn't realize it was his birthday. If I knew it was his birthday and shit, I would have been more worried.
Oh, man. Speaking of birthdays, isn't your birthday tomorrow?
Oh, yeah. Yes, it is.
Thanks, wow. Man. First,
you remember, first time you podcast remember.
Your birthday.
Thanks, man.
That's it.
39. That's 39 years old.
Very blah. Very blah birthday.
Ugh. Yeah. Staring down the barrel. 40.
40. Not as hard as 30.
My not opinion. As hard.
I was unemployed.
Not as hard as 30. Oh. Well, look at you. And now you have a master's degree. And a job.
That's it. Wife and kids.
I made beast. It. Just an absolute beast. Man. Incredible.
Thanks for remembering my master's degree, man. It's not that memorable.
How could I forget? I'm disappointed. I was like, "Oh man, he's better than me." The person.
So that's what my like my Baruch MPA. Nobody even knows what an MPA is.
Well, I called it a master's. It's not
a master's. Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
That's it. We don't need to go into the details. No details. Acronyms. Are complex. What do you think of my? What do you think of Jacoby? Little overpay for Jacoby Meyer.
I don't. So I was actually thought about that not a lot because I'm not on Team Grind, so I don't spend too much time thinking about it. But if I did, I would have thought, you know, it's a really bad. I mean, he's the number one receiver, right? So, but it's a really bad offense, and I don't think he's going to score that many touchdowns. But I also don't think that there's that many people. I don't know. That's fine. You want the guy, go get him. I don't have a problem.
Really? You thought about it a lot, but you didn't have a strong opinion.
I thought about it because, like, I don't know. Like, so, for example, if you really want to – I would – if I was you, I would have bid on Alec Pierce instead.
That's, because, I mean, you think, like, this year you're going to value Alec Pierce over Jacoby Meyers?
Yeah, I think at the end of the year – Alec Pierce has a higher ceiling. Like, I think you know what Jacoby – we know what Jacoby Meyers is. He's on a team that's led by Joe Judge and Matt Patricia. This is his unit. And, you know, he's got Noodle Arm, Chad Pennington the second as his quarterback. And then –
which one? Who's that?
That's Mac Jones. Mac Jones.
He is like Chad Pennington. I mean, exactly. He has 14 points a game. He has 14 points a game, three games.
He, like, but Mac Jones, you know, shout out to him. He, like, his dancing in the end zone, more impressive.
He's gritty. You liked his gritty?
I just think, like, you know, and then he did the thing where he's like, look at me, I can run. Ha ha. Like, he did this, like, you know, this other little dance that I was like, wow, all right.
I like Mac Jones. I think he's pretty good. Pats are good. Everybody, Willits especially, hates on the Pats this year. The Pats are – they're going to – Bill Belichick's going to get this team to 9 wins. Book it.
He always does. He's a G. That's what Bill does. You're like, oh, he's starting to lose it. I'm like, nah, he's still a G. Shut the best team. The best offense in the league. Zero.
So awesome. Only Bill Belichick does that. This team's scoring 35 points a game. And he's just like, no, we're not going to let them score at all. Only Belichick really executes the true shutouts, too. You know, he takes pride in that. Everybody else, like, they figure out a way to they get 3, they get 7. They just.
I'll go as far as to say Dan Campbell, also a G, because he didn't take any field goal. He didn't take no easy way out.
I agree with that. That's it, because he's trying to get you to the abyss. He's going to drag you
drown
out.
You.
Just get a hold of your ankle. He's gonna pull you out to the abyss, drown you.
What imagery.
A great speech. That man. Guy, he, you know, I think that he really like, he was like, this is my moment. I'm opening Hard Knocks with HBO. Everybody watches this. I might not be a great coach, but I'm gonna work forever right now because of this dope speech. He could get fired in the middle of the season. He'd be working. They'd probably put him
on. I think he guaranteed a second job. He got a second job with that speech for sure.
He's gonna be high price. He could get a contract immediately. Whenever he's fired, he's going to work in a studio show. That's it. You know, he doesn't have to do the broadcast. He's around the table talking shit. He'll probably be on Inside the NFL.
And he deserved it. He earned it. He gave a speech that was like, should have been from a movie. Speech was so good. Great speaker. Bad okay. coach. Dummy. He's real. He's a
dummy. We're going to start what is this called? A game show. Our first game show is Guess That Projection. Okay.
And then I didn't know what was happening. I really didn't know.
Yeah, no. I know. I wanted to catch you sleeper. Okay. All right. So this is a game that we called Guess the Projection, and I am going to throw out random players who we are not privy to their projection. Hopefully, I don't know. Mikey is a projection studier, so we'll see how good he is at remembering them.
I'm going to be honest with you. I have to be honest with you if I know the projection because I've looked at.
Choose a different one. And we're going to guess that we will each guess, and whoever's closest will be the winner.
That's great. How many are we going to do?
Four. I got four. First up, Najee Harris.
Ooh, that's a good one. I don't know what Najee Harris project. I haven't looked at it. I'm going to put Najee on 12.32. That's my guess.
Okay, I'm going to go with 11.45.
Okay.
Okay, next up.
Wait, you don't want to look at it? You don't want to do it right now? Why don't we look at it?
12 point. What is it? 12.23, you said?
Wow, man. You got – what'd you say?
I wrote it down. 11.45.
Wow, you got it. 11.63.
Woo!
All right.
You know, I just think, like, you know, he was a guy last year. He's projecting 15, 16, that kind of thing. And I don't think there's much confidence in him out there in the projection world. I just thought, you know, low ball.
I'd have man, low ball or something. I don't think I really knew the extent of how bad his season has been. Golly, he ran doesn't have more than an 11.
Well, somebody you were down on originally. You didn't like him.
He's not good. I always thought that. And that's what you need to remember. Don't just base on easy. Sometimes people aren't good, and then come back around and get you.
Mm-hmm. All right, next up, Kyle Pitts. Come on down.
I've looked at this one. I know this one.
Oh, okay, skip it. All right, you got to replace it. You pick one.
I got a good one for you, but you can tell me if you know it. Okay. DeAndre Hopkins went the week he returns. Have you looked?
Oh, I know that really well.
you put him in his lineup, right? You set your week 7.
Oh, yeah. Of course. Does that not qualify for team grind? Setting no, future that's just week
like,
lineups?
That's like your weird right. man. That's a weird.
I see that. Oh, I see.
Wow. okay. No, you do it. You're
Cam good. Akers.
Oh my God, my nemesis. I have not looked, although I have constantly been amazed at the awfulness of the projection.
I don't know.
I think they might be coming back, but it's really hard to say because they've been so wrong, except for the one week I called it out. But I think that they haven't quite figured it out. But it's lower. Last week, I know it was double digits. It was terrible projection. They gave this dude 13 carries. What do you get? He got a 3.5. Josh still has him on his team, I think. 9.15. That's my guess.
Okay, I'm going 7.93. That's my guess. I think, you know, he's a bum. So,
that's what I didn't take that into account.
They may not. They just take other things into account.
Oh, no, okay, I got you again, man.
You got me?
I didn't get you again. I just overprojected.
It's the first
9.71.
time.
I was very close.
9.71.
Ridiculous.
Wow, really?
You take the under. You know, I did a 10-leg parlay last week.
Oh, my God.
Really funny. Just for the day, you know?
Right.
For like one day, you're like, wow, I'm going to be rich tomorrow.
Right.
And It was 501. It was really fun. I won 7 of the 10 legs.
Oh, not bad.
No, it wasn't bad. One of the legs I lost was Damian Harris got hurt.
Oh.
Kareem Hunt, J.K. Dobbins came like 5 yards short too. I was very close to winning 9 out of 10. Obviously, Damian Harris getting hurt ruined it. But you know what? The only under I took, easiest one, Cam Akers got 13 carries. I took under 45 yards. And
that's amazing.
And it was easy. We never sweated about that one. I had already lost the bet anyway. 10 leg parlays, man.
That's cool. It's nothing like it. Nothing like a degenerate mini gambler. $3 here, $4 there.
You put $10 on it, and
now you dream of winning $5,500.
It's actually the best way to do it. You don't get yourself in trouble. Okay, last one. This guy is skyrocketing everywhere in the fantasy world. Breece Hall.
Oh, man. That's got to be pretty high.
I'm going to go first. I'm going to go because, you know, the advantage is going second. So I'm going to go ahead and say, like, this guy, you know, man, what an awesome player. He looks so good to me. I love his little, like, he reaches out with the ball to score the touchdown. You know, like, he does the, like, really crafty, like, just put the edge of the ball over the goal line touchdown thing. He's dope. I think he's the man. I'm going to go with 13-5-7.
Okay. I think you're a little high. They're a little
conservative
projections. 12-8, 12-8-1.
Ooh, okay. What do we got? Poo-poo platter. Let's see it. 12.80. 12.
No.
Yeah.
Oh,
you
wow.
Say 12.81?
I said 12.81.
That's incredible. That's incredible. Wow. What a thing to drop the mic on. So you won this round 2-1. I don't like losing to you. I already told you I don't like to lose to you or Mike.
Oh, wow. Well, it's played Justin Fields in this game. That can't be fun, man.
He went for it.
Threw a pick on the goal line because it takes him so long to throw. Everybody knows where he's going. Lyman, did you see it? You didn't see it. Lyman hit it. And caught his own pick.
Oh, wow.
There was a great rant on the Manning cast a few weeks ago where I don't remember. I think Cooper Rush was throwing. It was a Monday night game, obviously. And one of the linemen knocked it down. And you've never seen Peyton Manning so mad because – He's like, lineman taking a playoff, not even rushing the quarterback, just standing back, puts his hands up. He's like, should be banned. Should be banned. He said, yeah. shouldn't be allowed. Should be banned. He's dead serious. No, he's not even smiling.
That's funny.
It was so funny. He doesn't like that they play zone. He must not like zone blitzes.
Yeah, he doesn't like that.
He's like, if you're a lineman, you got to rush.
Yeah, you got to rush. Keep your hands down.
So funny. He's really pissed.
Oh, man, what a great guy. Okay. Well, listen, man, this has been such a wonderful little over an hour.
As it wow, is that an hour?
At least. I think it's... You know, I don't have the stopwatch going, but I think it's about an hour, man.
They do time the calls.
You know, it's pretty amazing. Yeah, I don't know where they keep that.
it's okay.
You know,
you can look at it after you download.
You know where they? You know, it's pretty amazing. I think if you look at the length of the last two, I think they're like 1 minute apart.
Oh wow! Maybe next week we can do over unders previous Zoom call. Give your podcast lights.
Yeah.
No, you know,
you like some follow-ups.
You know what?
Sure.
I say something that's totally irrelevant, but
yeah.
When I gave Lola to the people on the bus this morning, they asked me if I was a newscaster.
A newscaster? For what?
Lola, who asked you that? There's a bus driver and an aide, Mike and Linda. And Linda, and Lola's the first person who gets on a bus, very small bus, just a few children. I think it's wheelchair accessible. I think there's a child in a wheelchair that gets on at a certain point. And Linda, she goes, are you on the news?
I was like,
said, no.
They both thought it. They both thought I was a newscaster. That's what they said.
Wow.
And I should have said that I do podcasts.
You did that thing where you like laugh and you smile. Like you're like,
no. No, I was like, I'm not. I didn't know I did. Yeah, I was like, I'm not. I should. And then I was like, I should do the news.
I should be. I should.
And then normally I like wave to Lola, like, because she wants me to wave to her as the bus goes away. But I was so like smitten with myself. I just walked away, like smiling.
Was she mad at you? Did she tell you about it when you came and picked her up?
I don't know. I don't. She didn't. She didn't remember at the end of the day. Or she didn't mention it. So
shout out Lola, Lola B. Shout out Sammy.
Yeah. And you know, since the last podcast, also potty trained. How about that? Successful.
Hey. My man.
Sammy Pease. You want to know how he does potty training? He does not use the potty, nor have an accident. He just doesn't. He pees twice a day. 7:30 a.m. 2:30 p.m. Put him in a diaper, dry diaper. 7:30 next morning. Two times.
He needs more water.
He can get more water. He's drinking. He's drinking water.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Is he really yellow? Or is it?
I don't know. He asked me to leave the room while he pees.
So Eli literally doesn't pee at school. For the whole day. So it's a very similar time. Like sometimes he doesn't pee. Like, you know how you pee right when you get up in the morning? Because that's just, you know, most people do that.
I poop when I get up in the morning.
Right. That's amazing to go from asleep to pooping. It's incredible. But this kid, he'll get all the way to school and he will not have pee in the morning when he wakes up. Like he doesn't pee between when he wakes up and when he goes to school. And then he won't pee at school. He makes up this thing about bullies in the bathroom. Like it's like grease or something like that. And there's like bullies in there waiting for him. Like, you know?
So he goes 8 hours without peeing from when he wakes up.
It's incredible.
It is incredible. These guys have self-control. I mean, Sam goes about 15 hours. Though. What's 2:30 p.m. to 7:30?
That's insane. That's insane. He's not drinking water. He's not drinking water.
No, enough water. You can't tell Sam what to do, though. He doesn't. Today
he's not into that.
He had to bring his boot. He had to carry his rain boots to school in a plastic bag.
Yeah. I can't even have rain boots. I don't even know what those are.
You're saying it doesn't rain? That's your
point.
Doesn't rain. Well, must be nice.
Well, you guys should all think about moving out here. All of you.
I like a little
change in my season.
A little adversity in my life. Like a little bit of challenge.
Except when somebody rushes you. Forget about it. No, as long as it's on your own time. Challenges on your own time. I'm with you.
That should be the name of my memoir.
Challenges on his own time by Michael.
His own time. I would say on my own time. It's my memoir. It's not written by somebody else.
Oh, I feel like I could write it.
You could try.
Probably.
Yeah, maybe we could podcast it.
Oh, audiobook. Our first audiobook.
Oh, man. Great. Wow.
Hey, man, you're a special guy.
Covered some ground.
Yeah, no, this is great. I enjoy that horrible game you're watching. Have a wonderful, wonderful weekend. My best to your family. Tell everybody I say hello. Is there any friend plans this weekend I should be jealous about?
I just got local friends. New friends. Friends.
Oh. Do your old friends know about your new friends? Everybody know about them?
Yeah, I mean, you're an old friend. Oh, okay. Do you know about them?
I do, but it feels like different because I'm so far away.
Oh, my God. I just want to say Justin Fields just blew a bunny touchdown. It sucks. Sorry. Sorry. That was awful.
That's shitting on Willits.
I'll make that throw that he just missed. 100 times out of 100. I would never
Not with a helmet and shoulder pads on. No way.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, all right.
Guaranteed. All right. Every single time.
I love it. These regular human beings, like, just saying stuff like, they know what they can do.
Well, it's definitely got sad after that one. That one hurt. Yeah.
That's a hurt. Yeah, I mean, he spent all of his touchdowns on my face last Monday, so.
That's it.
You know.
He's probably going to get a
huge. You ever have a Monday night game that you're losing where you got 5 touchdowns in it? Did that ever happen for you?
No, it's like some of these people
are non-quarterback really touchdown. 5 non-quarterback.
No, touchdowns. you're blessed. I guess I've had some good comebacks, but I can't really remember the 5 touchdowns on a Monday night. You were talking about etiquette before, and we never talked about the worst etiquette travesty in our league was when I lost to Willis in the semifinals.
Oh.
On the most garbage time touchdown of all time. And Handel with Willis texted me. He dreamt it. That was his book. He dreamt it. Like, they were out at a bar. Willis had a dream. And I had to hear about this. You remember.
Oh, God.
I had to hear about the dream Willis had that they were at this bar and he won, blah, blah, blah. Anyway.
Yeah.
That's all.
Yeah.
All right. You stop paying attention to. Nope, we do.
No. I was paying attention to that. all right, man. Well, hey, listen. Love you. Talk to you. See you next Thursday. Thank you to all. Don't forget about the email. We got the email up. You can.
You didn't get
drop us an email.
Big surprise. No. No questions from the audience this week.
I don't know. I didn't check. Actually, you're silly me.
Well, so okay. Well, so you forgot. Check. About, you forgot. About. Hold on.
Before we blow it here, I feel like I should.
I feel like the best chance that we have is like Josh, like, made a fake Gmail account and sent like a prank question.
Right. Most... That's what we're hoping for. Okay. Yep. No new mail. Oh, well.
Yep, that's predictable.
Predictable.
Bad way on the show, man.
Yeah.
Up all right, buddy. With our fans.
Yeah. Okay, man. Great.
All right. Stuff. Thanks. Thanks, buddy.
Thanks. Thanks every time. Thank you. Okay, man. Have a wonderful night.
You jump. Happy birthday.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Very good night.
All right.